My name is Erwin Nanda, and I'm the Executive Vice President of the Ontario Federation of Labor. And just to let you know, where the press conference is going to go is that I'll be saying some words on behalf of the Ontario Federation of Labor. You'll be hearing from various family members and then the advocacy groups, and then we'll take questions at the end. We are co-hosting the media conference immediately before today's mass rally at noon to call for justice for Sammy Yuten. What happened to Sammy Yuten was deplorable and totally avoidable. But what is more alarming is the remarkable similarities this case has with other police shootings in Toronto and elsewhere across the province. What sets this tragedy apart is that it was all captured on video. On the viewing of the evidence that is widely circulating, many have described the Yuten shooting as an execution. In the video, you can clearly see a distressed Toronto teenager who is posed no obvious or immediate threat to any officer or member of the public, get shot by one officer in a volley of 9 bullets, and then tasered by another officer. The public is notably outraged, and the OFL has joined forces with community and families of victims of police shooting to demand answers. But we are here today to say that Sammy Yuten wasn't just killed by a spray of police bullets. He was killed by a total breakdown in the policing system. Literally decades of reports, inquests, and recommendations are gathering dust on police station cells while the bodies of victims are piling up. At today's media conference, you will hear directly from families, lawyers, and advocates who have been working on these tragic cases. In their own words, they will share their stories of the preventable tragedies they have faced, the startling similarities in their cases, and the actions they want to see taken to bring justice to their loved ones and to ensure that these lives have not been lost in vain. Many reporters have been asking, why has the OFL taken an interest in this case? The OFL has been working closely with the community to take action on this case and to call for broader action because our members expect us to. Working people across the province are concerned about the safety and security of our families and our children in the streets of our city. We are demanding a full and independent investigation of police response and conflict resolution that covers right from the Attorney General's office to the frontline response. This is why we have partnered with the Urban Alliance on Race Relations, the Black Action Defense Coalition, the families of the victim, and their organization, From Grief to Action. What are we calling for? I will let the families and advocates share their own demands, but I will say that the OFL stands strongly in support of the Ombudsman's announcement that his office will be conducting an extensive probe into police guidelines all across the province. This is precisely what the OFL and others have been calling for, and we expect the police departments in every city to fully cooperate with that investigation. However, we think the investigation must go further. The Ombudsman has made it clear that he will be looking at everything except the Yuten case. While we would not want the Ombudsman probe to interfere with the SIU investigation, we believe that there must be more that must be investigated. We are concerned about the deeply entrenched shortcomings of the SIU. For example, the SIU is essentially only looking at one officer and one aspect of this tragedy, the fatal discharge of his firearm. But there are many other questions about why this incident resulted in a tragedy. For example, who was in charge of the scene? Why did the officers try to de-escalate the situation before responding with deadly force? Why was a mobile crisis unit not called in? Why didn't the emergency task force take control of the scene? After all, aren't they the most qualified? Why is only one officer being investigated when a second officer tasered the victim after he was shot? All these questions allude to a systemic problem with the overall police response. The family and the public deserve a response. We are demanding an independent investigation into police training, policies, and practices from the highest level of the decision-making right down to the frontline response. It is not enough to have Toronto Police Chief Bill Blair announce a review of local policies, because the reality is there are over 52 police chiefs in 52 police departments in Ontario, and each one of them has their own policies and practices, but the tragedies are identical. It is time for the government of Ontario to take the responsibility and institute a province-wide overhaul on police training, policy, and practice, to change the culture of police and save the lives through de-escalation rather than deadly force. This isn't a case of one bad apple or even one bad girl. This is about the whole approach to policing that is failing the very people it is intended to protect. Every force must have a uniform response, and it's up to the Attorney General to ensure that it shouldn't matter where you live if it will determine whether you end up in a psychiatric office or a body bag. Thank you. Now I'm going to turn it over to Karen Greenwood Graham, and she's a family.
And we're traumatization of our own experiences, and we are really, really reeling from this killing. We're actually in a David and Goliath battle here, and I'd like to ask the public to actually get behind us and actually call their MPPs and insist on change. While BC Toronto have the supports of unions, the associations, and lawyers, we grieving families have nothing. We have no trauma supports when this happens. And it relates to damage. And I can only speak personally for me at this point. Sam and Tim's death is preventable. All our loved ones' deaths are preventable. As been said before, there's been many, many reports that have come out about change and how many coroners and inquiries you have to go through. And how many recommendations do we have to have come out of these coroner's inquests? For the police to listen, for the Attorney General's office to listen, for all of the bodies. I spoke to the actual lady that follows up with these recommendations. She has told me they filed them. Does that make you feel good about the recommendations and the money that taxpayers are paying for coroner's inquests? It's millions of dollars here that taxpayers are paying for, and we're paying for it in lives of life. It's wrong. De-escalation is key. When somebody's in a crisis, I don't care if it's mental or otherwise, a life crisis, yelling at someone just exacerbates that fight or flight response. Right? I mean, anybody can relate to that. We're all human. And it doesn't help. So for the police to be trained in the way to control, it's wrong. It's so wrong. It's got to be a more human approach. It really does. Fight or flight response is very, very real and very human, and it's expected. You cannot say it's not expected. We cannot any longer accept the way people are gunned down in lawful practice. We don't want to accept that anymore. I am calling to Andrew Marin, our ombudsman for this province, to meet with the affected families of police homicide. I'm asking his office to meet with us to talk about what we feel we could bring to the table of even better solutions that Bill Blair brought. Because what Bill Blair is talking about right now is tokenism. It's pure tokenism. Tokenism is shallow. He's been forced to do it. He's been a puppeteer in all of this. He's been a puppeteer in all of this. And Bill Blair, you need to wake up. I presented to him last year and said, you need to wake up now, and it hasn't been done. So please, you know, everybody watching this, do something about it. Because if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Her family is ruined, and it's just a horrible time for her.
I'm the sister of Byron Zosky. I'm here with my daughter's Byron's nieces. And I guess what I just wanted to do was that it really re-traumatizes, like Karen said, it re-traumatizes the families. It opens those wounds again when you see another person who was shot and killed. And the difference with this, I guess, from our family is that ours wasn't caught on video. And because this one was caught on video, it sparked that report that people actually seen for themselves what's been going on. So, you know, it's just re-traumatizing.
So we're going to next have Ruth Schaefer.
Hi, thanks for coming everybody and showing interest. And I'm so happy that the Urban Alliance on Race Relations is here. And the OFO is here, and more people who are representing different groups of people show up to speak about these have been extremely worried about right after my son was shot and killed. All the articles I was reading and things I was hearing on the radio really centered on the fact that people who are shot and killed have some type of brain illness. And so the general public seems to think that the only people who are shot and killed are people with a brain illness, which isn't true. There are various groups of people in Canada who are far more at risk from police targeting than other groups of people. Anybody who is identifiably poor, anybody who is identifiably First Nations, anybody who is of color, anybody who is identifiably mentally ill. And I believe that it is a mark of the demographic disappear. How many of our own people are killed by our state? So in our country, what is it? In Ontario, I believe it's about 200 people a year. Which makes me very much wonder about the idea of democracy. In trying to create change, I think we have to look at what's already been done. We have studies and reports gathering dust in places all over this country. We've paid probably millions of tax dollars to have those things done. All the recommendations that need to be put in place to safeguard the life of Canadian citizens are sitting in print for anybody who's interested to implement those things. Talking about inquest recommendations, and lots of recommendations have been made, and as far as I know, I haven't seen any of them implemented. Maybe that's because the individual police services get to decide which ones get implemented. So where is our provincial government? So it makes me wonder. I'm going to court. In my first court action, I was expecting the Ministry of the Attorney General to send four lawyers to argue on behalf of the SIU. At 10:30 p.m. on the night before our first court date, the Ministry of the Attorney General withdrew all that support. I believe that points to a complete lack of political will from the provincial government to do anything about this situation. So, one thing that can be done about that is if people write a letter to the Ministry of the Attorney General, asking him to institute the recommendations in the Ontario Ombudsman's report, both from this year and last year, and also to stop the Ministry of the Attorney General from directing the SIU director not to publish his reports to make them public, which is untenable. Obvious. I think Bill Blair's statements are actually very insulting to you. I found his statements insulting and hurtful and extremely ridiculous. And I'm paying big wages with my taxes. I'm also paying the cost wages with my taxes. Bill Blair knows that this report has been done already. How dare he decide to have another one and spend all our money on those reports? We also, families are in a very serious position when somebody is killed privately. We don't have the kind of briefing that we want the police to have. I'm a single mother of three children. I raised three children. And then, when they were grown and left, I realized that, raising three children on my own, I have no money. So I got, and then I had to develop schizophrenia. So in order to deal with that, I worked three jobs for 12 years. All I did for 12 years was spend time with my grandchildren and my son who needed my attention and make money so that I could provide for him. My son had schizophrenia, but he was a very, very bright man. Very important in his family. The last picture that was taken of him is him holding his nephew that was about a month old. So when I decided to do something, my son was killed in a very remote area and there were no witnesses I found 2 weeks after his death that the SIU director had very publicly announced that he couldn't make any charges in this case because of the behavior of the officers involved. There was no reliable evidence to go on. Except for, I found out at the inquest that one of those police officers, the police officer who killed my son, took nothing with him except a gun. That's all he had. Which says to me that he was only interested in shooting somebody. And when I came to go to court, my life savings were given to the lawyer. And then I was very lucky because I had friends who would know how to fundraise. So then my friends started to fundraise. We haven't finished paying for it. The police have almost unlimited resources. We had one day in the Supreme Court. The police lawyer, Greenspan, actually said in court, it's okay if a lawyer helps the police to write the note. Whole idea of notes is that they're independent, contemporaneous. I have worked in a job where I have to keep notes. I would have expected to be fired if I didn't keep notes and keep them in a contemporaneous and independent fashion. And how can somebody else help me write my notes without input to me? It's not possible. I'm still reeling from my son's death. I don't think that such violent killing with somebody one lot can ever be got over. So I don't think I will ever get over that, and I don't think my children will ever get over that. Hopefully we can learn to manage it, but I have a feeling to go back to work again. So the first of all, the police kill somebody, and then just all this collateral damage. Victim Services offered me no help. I'm just lucky that I have a background in advocacy, and it was automatic for me to call them and demand it. But even at that, I got 10 weeks to learn to manage the particular killing of my child. That has been everything. It actually for everything.
Justice system, the police system, have failed us again. And when I look back at all the inquests that happened before O'Brien's death, O'Brien's inquest that I spent many days in, and all the recommendations that came out of that inquest, and then nothing was done, and the justice system that we believe in, that is asked to believe in, has failed us. Again. So it's not only the cops that are failing us, and I believe there are good cops out there, but there's some of them that are failing us. And the justice system is failing us because they're allowing them to get away with it. You know what? I hope this is the last death this year. I hope the rally that's called today. I hope that all of this that's happening is gonna have an impact on the justice system. I'm hoping that this is not just another show. Mothers are losing their sons. My daughter lost her brother. My son lost his brother. He's still going through a hard time because of that. I don't live a day without thinking about O'Brien and what he did, why he was gunned down the way he did. I can't even begin to imagine what his family's going through. He was on the bus alone, contained. Why did they have to shoot him? O'Brien was in a park. I mean, he was not going anywhere. Why did they have to shoot him? You know, as I said, enough. Enough. Something has to be done. And until the system starts to hold the officers who do these things responsibly, it's going to keep happening again and again and again, and we're going to keep meeting here again and again, and people are going to waste time again and again, going to be called for juries and inquests and all these things, and some who lose their faith. What's the point of all of this if nothing's going to happen? Do I sound angry? Yes, I am angry. I'm angry because another mother lost her 18-year-old son at a time when it should not have happened, because I was at that inquest for O'Brien every single day, and I know the recommendation that came out of there. And when I heard what happened, I said nothing. None of the recommendations were followed. Otherwise, Sammy would have been alive. Mm-hmm. And it's time we do something about it. And that's all I have to say.
These are real people who get killed, you know. They're not just abstract. They have mothers and people who love them. And some of us work with them for years and get to love them in absentia. It's not we're ready. It's good that there are. I'm sorry, I get emotional. Sometimes there's just the time, and it's embarrassing to do it in front of so many people. But we've had a lot of investigations. We've had a huge number of recommendations. The recommendations don't get followed on the street. They get followed in training. There's excellent training sometimes. They show police officers de-escalating, calming people down. They do that in training. It comes to the street, and now we all saw in Sammy Yateen's case by video what they do. A number of officers standing around with guns yelling at him. None of them tries to make any approach to him. None of them says, sorry, you seem to have a problem here. You haven't hurt anybody, there's nobody around, it's going to be okay. Maybe that wouldn't work, but it has to be tried, and it would work in many cases. And jury after jury has told the police that's what they have to do, de-escalate. And training does it, and it doesn't happen. Why doesn't it happen? Because the police are not police. The SIU has the responsibility of determining if criminal charges should be made. And they very rarely say yes to that. But then the chief of police has a responsibility to discipline officers who fail to follow training. Chief Blair's statement yesterday was extremely disappointing. He's somebody who has power to do things, not just to talk like the rest of us, not just to recommend like juries. He has power. What he should do in this circumstance as a minimum is say, henceforth, any officers who do not follow proper de-escalation procedures in situations like this are going to suffer in a disciplinary manner, whether or not they suffer from the SIU charges. He says now he's coming out with a report, and he's going to make this one public. Make all of them public. Make the one of Michael Elligon from a year and a half ago public. Why doesn't he make that public? I think his report would be embarrassing because it would not criticize any of the officers for, again, in the same situation, failing to try de-escalation techniques. The Elligon case and the Yateen case are remarkably similar. No members of the public at risk of any kind. Nobody there but police officers, a large number of police officers with guns. And the poor person by himself being yelled at, and not one officer trying to approach that person to de-escalate. That has to change, and I ask Superintendent Chief Blair to make a statement today that he will not tolerate officers failing to try de-escalation techniques in this situation. He doesn't need any more recommendations to make a strong statement like that. Thanks very much.
All of Gary Peters' office. Promoting harmonious relationships with our diverse communities is at the foremost of the education, research, and advocacy functions that we conduct as part of the Harmon Alliance on Race Relations. We have come together to focus on better training, oversight, and monitoring of the training that our police officers receive, and the importance of investing in such training to build a solid relationship between our police and the public. The protect and serve involves mental health training to better meet the needs of vulnerable populations. And
I know that some of the other lawyers, some of the lawyers that will come up will speak to LS 13, which is the police policies and procedures on dealing with people who are mentally ill or have mental health issues or emotionally disturbed or developmentally disabled. Today, many families in the room are without their sons. The tragedy that occurred with Sami Yatim could have been avoided. The fatal shooting of Sami Yatim and the immediate public outcry brought back painful memories of the numerous victims of police violence in Toronto. We also see similar patterns of the use of lethal force in other large cities across Ontario and Canada. And these also follow the same pattern of behavior in that they also involve people with mental health issues, people who are emotionally disturbed, people with developmentally who are developmentally disabled, but also they also include a large segment of our population who are racialized and who are normal law-abiding citizens who may be in conflict with the law, and instead of using de-escalation tactics, the police are using lethal force. For those of us with long memories, there have been many similar fatal shootings in Toronto. After much soul searching through the years, the Urban Alliance on Race Relations, along with the Queen Street Patient Council and other groups including the Black Action Defense Committee, Aboriginal Legal Services, the Chinese Canadian National Council organized a conference from which this report came about called Saving Lives, Alternatives to the Lethal Use of Force by Police. The main topics of the conference was on the use of less than lethal technology, mental health issues, issues of race in police shooting, and barriers to change. The purpose of the event was to build bridges, to find solutions, and to bring together our diverse communities, police, and other public officials to work much harder to save lives and improve the quality of life of all our citizens in Toronto. A lot of work has been done. Issues were identified and recommendations was published in 2002. Reflecting now on yet another police shooting, it is not difficult to be cynical and ask the question, after all of these years of public concern and efforts to bring police into conversations so that we're not talking among ourselves, why is there such a disconnect between police training and the behavior of some of the rank and file officers? Why was Sami Yatim shot 9 times while he was down, then tasered? There are many questions not being asked and many answers not being provided. There are mechanisms that exist to hold our police accountable to their own, to build public trust and public confidence to serve and protect. The Special Investigations Unit, the Office of the Independent Police Review Director, the Policing Standards Division of the Public Safety Unit of the Ministry of Community Safety and Correctional Services, the Toronto Police Services Board, the Police Services Act, the Ombudsman, and many other bodies exist. While all these bodies are entrusted with protecting the public interest, who among them is monitoring, asking questions, receiving answers, and who is the police accountable to? We are dismayed that we have to start all over again to question the system of police training, accountability, and oversight, and the administration of justice in addressing policing and police conduct. However, we believe that the police must be prepared to listen, accept, and acknowledge their mistakes. They must make the necessary corrections of the deficiencies that exist, and they must be prepared to accept help and additional assistance when needed from community-based organizations, mental health professionals, in language interpreters and translators, social workers, and people at all levels of society who understand and can educate on the complexities and the risk factors in dealing with our increasingly diverse and in some cases vulnerable citizens of this city. We hope that this press conference and the subsequent rally will be an opportunity to translate our energies towards meaningful solutions for the good of the community, the good of the city, and the betterment of policing in this diverse city. We urge greater political will from our elected officials and public oversight bodies to rebuild public trust in our policing, law enforcement, and public safety mechanisms in this diverse city. We want to see results. That's all we ask. Thank you.
Anything with my twin brother in a public capacity. But I've been on both sides, actually. I've represented police officers, actually, who were part of SIU investigations, and I've represented citizens as well who have been shot by the police last July. I represented a teenage boy, a 17-year-old boy, who was shot by the police. He survived the shooting, and so he's one of the few mentally ill persons who encountered the police who actually survived the shooting. And he was shot at by the police officer 8 times shortly after the officer appeared on the scene while he was undergoing a mental health crisis. And so the difficulty with the Yatin case is similar to the case that I dealt with last July, is that the Ministry of Community Safety and Correctional Services has a police standards branch that brings out provincial-wide policies to govern the police interaction with mentally disturbed people and emotionally disturbed people or other persons in crisis. The policy Gary referred to, LE-013, deals specifically with that. And as Peter Rosenthal spoke to directly, training is provided in that area. However, when the police get into the field, there seems to be a disconnect between the training that they're provided with in police college and what actually happens on the ground. And in this case, we were fortunate enough to have a multiplicity of video evidence that certainly will, I can assure you, contradict whatever the police have already written in their notes. We have issues of accountability, and I agree with Ruth's comments about the chief's interview yesterday. The chief is in charge of Toronto police operations, and he is there to provide some measure of assurance to the citizens of Toronto that we will be properly served and protected. His statements yesterday give us no such assurance. Police officers are given tremendous amount of power, and in carrying a 9mm with 15 rounds, they're given power over our lives while we're on the street. And some citizens will be in crisis. Police officers are trained to use proper use of force techniques, and that's why we have a use of force continuum, which appeared to not have been followed in this case. And so the Saving Lives report that Gary referred to earlier, the inquest that some of the families spoke of, all those things need to put into account, and the recommendations need to be put into force. I don't know whether it takes class action lawsuits in order to get the police to do what it needs to do. It may well be the case that we need to be ramping up civil actions against the police and holding them financially liable for all the mistakes and errors in judgments that have caused lives or serious injuries to citizens in this city, given all the policies that exist, all the recommendations that exist, some of which are gathering dust. And I thank you all for coming out today.
Selwyn, sorry.
When written presentation, I just want to comment briefly on what Selwyn said and some of the other people. A lot that I'm going to deal with today is placing what is happening to us in a historical perspective. One thing I want you to understand, when individuals go to the police academy, they only learn 20% really of what it takes to be a police officer in Ontario. The other 80% really is taught to them on the job training. So I do applaud Andre Morin looking into the training of police officers, because it's within that training, that in-house training, that all of the negative ethos of the thin blue line and the, everything that goes with it becomes inculcated into these young men and women, so that they no longer serve and protect the public, but they serve and protect the thin blue line and each other. My name is Ruben Aviv, and I'm actually a senior activist with the Black Action Defense Committee. But today I'm here representing the National Conference of Black Lawyers, Toronto Chapter, and the Never Again Coalition. I sit before you this morning dressed in a hospital gown. It is uncomfortable and it is symbolic. It is uncomfortable and it is symbolic. On February 3rd, 2012, Michael Elagon Jr. was gunned down while wearing a hospital gown not dissimilar to the one I wear today. That Michael needed help did not matter. He did not obey and he died. Here we are less than 18 months later and are mourning and activating for Sammy Yateen, another young soul taken from his family and his future by the Toronto Police excessive force. I want to break down a little bit of what I believe are a few uncommon symbolic facts which you may or may not know about the Toronto Police, Ontario Police in general, and the SIU. From 1995 to today, the SIU has investigated 87 firearm deaths by police, 338 custody deaths by police, 16 other types of deaths by police, for a grand total of 441 deaths at the hands of police in Ontario. 441 since 1995. Charges laid by the SIU on officers for excessive force, manslaughter, or murder, I believe the number is 3. With one conviction. That is a minus 441 average against the victims and families of police violence. I want to travel back in history a little bit. You'll be hearing from the Black Action Defense Committee. I sit here today with an image of Dudley Laws on my chest, and I carry the mentorship of Charles Roach within me. And for many years, these men were standing up very much alone, and I'm very happy to be here with the Ontario Federation of Labor and have all of you here today. Many times in the past, we have been very lonely and without you. But let's travel back a little bit to 1901 and begin to plot the number of violent deaths by firearms of Toronto police at the hands of criminals from 1991 until 2012, to date. You will find in 112 years, 17 young men have paid the ultimate supreme sacrifice of their lives in the line of duty. 17 men have died violent deaths by the hands of criminals in the Toronto police force in 112 years. May Toronto and Canada truly honor these fallen Toronto police officers. They too died unnecessarily. Yet in every case except for one, there was an arrest and a conviction. Yet the SIU investigated 17 police killings by firearm alone between 1995 and 1999. Between 2000 to 2008, when Ian Scott took over, there were 41 police killings. In Ian Scott's tenure, he has had 29 police killings by firearm. And how many charges laid? One. How many convictions? None. I'm cognizant of the time and we'll wrap up here in but a few moments, but I do so once again by delving into the history of brutal, violent, and righteous disregard for human rights, perpetrated especially but not exclusively by the Toronto Police Services. Something maybe you, many of you don't know. The origin of the Toronto Police Services began officially in 1834 when Toronto was officially incorporated. Between 1834 and 1859, 1860, there were 26 riots in Toronto, because of which the role of police officer in Toronto began as a paramilitary rebellion suppressor. It was not about fighting crime. It was about suppressing rebellion. Crime fighting was not much of a concern or a practice. In its early years, corruption in the Toronto police force was rife, and the entire police services was removed not once, but three times. Every officer, every senior officer gone before 1859. When it finally came time to hire a chief who would reinvent the force in 1859, Toronto had a choice. They had a choice in 1855. They wanted to look to London, England, to choose an officer from there to come to Toronto to make a police force based on the police force in London, England. But they didn't actually do that. When it came to hire a chief for the new Toronto police force in 1859, Toronto instead chose a military officer and not an experienced police officer. The new police chief was William Stratton Prince, a former captain of the 71st Highland Light Infantry Division, who saw much battle. Stratton Prince standardized training, hiring practices, and new strict rules of discipline and professional conduct were introduced. Today's Toronto Police Services directly traces its ethos, constitutional lineage, and police commission regulatory structure to these 1859 reforms by Stratton Prince. An ironic note, William Stratton Prince was the son of Colonel John Prince, who commanded the forces engaging the rebels at Windsor in 1838 in the rebellion between the United States and Canada, where he summarily shot rebel prisoners captured by his men. If Toronto was more concerned about rebellion and disorder than crime fighting, then certainly they had a new police chief in Stratton Prince, with rebel fighting both in his blood and his regimental history. Since those long ago days of Chief Stratton Prince, the Toronto Police has grown incredibly to where it now has a $1 billion budget. But along with this growth also has come a misplaced sense of entitlement in a force who publicly proclaim to serve and protect, but actually prepare to suppress rebellion in any form. It may be difficult for you to get beyond the uncomfortable symbolism of the ethos of Toronto Police today, is that their ancestral paramilitary rebellion suppressing role. But that is what the Toronto Police trained for, suppression of rebellion. That is why they are armed as they are. And so it is not 9mm they carry Glock 27s or Glock 22s, so they're 10mm, 40 caliber bullets, hollow point bullets. They have a muzzle velocity almost just a little bit under half of an assault rifle. This is what they are trained for. This is why they are armed. This is why they are armored. This is what they practice daily. This is what they yearn to fulfill, rebellion suppression. Unfortunately, even a rebellion shaded as a refusal to divulge one's personal information for no reasonable cause, or to refuse to stop being in crisis and respond as they order us. To the police in Ontario, and especially to the Toronto Police Services, this small act of rebellion evokes an ingrained and entitled blue line mandate for them to begin the dangerous escalation of their continual force protocol, where by all means necessary, they will command you, they will control you, they will subdue you, or they will hurt you, and maybe, likely, they will even kill you. When the police happens, the uncomfortable symbolism of justice denied occurs. On the one hand, you have a person who just died, was brutally shot or beaten or otherwise killed by police, with their shocked, bereaved, and overwhelmed families facing hopelessly the financial and legal reality of bad news, worse news, and finally, injustice. On the other hand, you have a well-paid, middle-class police officer who just killed somebody. Yet he knows he's sleeping in his own bed that night. He knows He will get 1 year off with pay. He knows his union will part the seas to protect him. He knows the SIU is mandated in the very belly of his own police act. He knows police culture will be used in the SIU investigation. He knows the media will howl. He knows the families will cry. He knows that he most likely will not be charged. He knows coroner's inquests are rare and no guilt is assigned or investigated. He knows civil suits are possible, but they always settle with gag orders restricting families' comments. He also knows most victim families will not bother with a civil case because they can't afford a lawyer, can't get legal aid, can't find a pro bono lawyer. He knows they will eventually forget and fade away. The Ontario Police, and especially the Urban Brothers, the Toronto Police Services, the service officer, knows his life will continue. The police officer knows he will never be held to account in this city, in this province, in this country. The police know they are free to kill, they are free to maim, to brutalize, to hurt, to intimidate, to cheat, and to lie. The police know and hold true to that eternal symbolic thin blue line of injustice and treat it as an entitlement. And our elected politicians continue to allow them to get away with it. As Joel Duff of the Ontario Federation of Labor remarked to me yesterday, the system is broken from the top to the bottom. Justice Adams stated in his 2003 report that the SIU is an important democratic tool for building the community's trust in the paramilitary organization we call police. Yet I tell you today, it has failed. A total rethink to real community-based policing is necessary. A system of real civilian oversight must be made a reality. How do we do that? Where do we start? I will end by honoring our great, late great mentors, Dudley Laws and Charles Roach, by leaving with you a few demands to chew on. Number one, to Premier Kathleen Wynne, fire or transfer Deputy Attorney General Patrick Monahan and his Assistant Deputy Attorney General of Agency Relations, Ali Arlani. Get rid of these two. They are a part of the problem, buffering and filtering realities to the elected echelon that are not the realities that the victims are facing on the street and their families are facing every day. Get rid of these bureaucrats. They have been there too long and they're not doing the job that we gave them. Number two, fire or transfer out of the SIU William Curtis, 22-year veteran of the Guelph Police Services, who is now listed on as the SIU Executive Director on the Attorney General's online organizational chart. Now, if Ian Scott is the director and William Curtis is the Executive Director, what is up with that? And William Curtis is the one who was answerable from the SIU to the Assistant Deputy Attorney General. And he's a cop. This is civilian oversight. This is the blockage there. Get rid of this man. This position should be equally sacrosanct as a citadel of civilian oversight of police. This position is the conduit and key to the ear of the elected echelon. Number three, fire Ian Scott. He is a good man, but not the man for this job. He lacks the will to ensure justice, even if it looks a losing cause. He lacks the will to let a judge and jury decide. Instead, preventing justice, denying justice to the victims, families, by never charging. Remove Ian Scott. Number four, remove the SIU from the Ontario Police Act and establish it as it was originally intended, as a direct arm of the Attorney General. It can no longer. Being within the Ontario Police Act is like trying to see your nose from the inside of your belly button. It does not work. Number five, order a full judicial review of all historic SIU cases involving death or injury by police. It is clear that we have a problem in the system. Number six, work, and this I hope Andre Morin will also work very hard to bring into reality. Work with the federal government to define and establish the tertiary curriculum for a civilian forensic homicide investigator program utilizing the existing universities in Ontario and Canada. The ethos now in the government and in the judiciary is that the only people who can investigate a homicide are police. It is a lie. They are blocking anybody else from getting the experience because they want to remain behind the thin blue line. Ladies and gentlemen, as Ruth Schaefer and many of the other families have said, we need to act. We do need to write letters. We do need to stand up, and today we do need to march. A year ago, at the Toronto Police Services Board, I wore this hospital gown, and it says, never again. When 18 months ago, we said never again that we wanted changes. Why are we here today, mourning and activating for Sammy Yateen? This is a political decision. The police will not change on their own. Let us not even talk to them too much. Let us change the politics. Thank you very much.
The continuation of the police use of deadly force in the community will further deteriorate police-community relations. We are deeply concerned that as governments, all levels have not realized and have not taken action beneficial to the Canadian society of the issue, despite hundreds of lives that have been lost. Police officers are authorized to carry a baton, handcuffs, a badge of authority, request backup, carry a gun, the power to arrest, and also the decision to cause life, to cause death of a citizen in the performance of his or her duty. They also have the support of the union. The citizen, even when their rights are violated, have no independent body to which they can complain about police abuse of power. For several years, the Black Action Defense Committee has been the leading organization in Canada advocating for police oversight at all levels of government, and have encouraged and supported the formation of the Special Investigation Committee. However, since its formation, the SIU has become a disappointment and is viewed by members of the community as a rubber-stamped arm of the police establishment, thereby making continuous decisions in the favor of the police. Any discussion of policing must include the recognition of the extraordinary power of the police. They are empowered by law to interfere with an individual's liberty in the most severe way. As a result of this state-sanctioned power, interaction between police and any individual person is by definition characterized by an imbalance of power. At the present, the citizens of Ontario and Canada are being disempowered because police officers can kill and get away with it. Civilians are being denied the ease of access for large companies. In general, it's easier for a cop to offend a citizen than for a citizen to file a complaint. Often, the victims are not financially sound to take their case to court, and in most instances, legal aid does not fund professional services against police. In light of this, we are not here to pass a broad indication that all police officers act in an unlawful manner in the performance of their duties. We therefore acknowledge and appreciate those officers who are trying to make police a respectable name. All we are saying is, if any of them act in such a manner of unnecessary, excessive use of force, they must be answerable to a body outside of themselves. The bad scene is not under any unrealistic assumption that being a professional means that a police officer must be able to excel at everything. There are several circumstances when an officer's assessment and negotiation skills come into play. Solving a problem or situation takes both analytical and creative skills, depending on the problem, which particular skill will vary. BADC advocates for policies and practices that are geared at the elimination of racism, and in carrying out its work, operates from a strong commitment to being a unifying force in the community and to be an advocate for positive changes. In BADC's presentation and recommendations in our community meetings, BADC's position has been very clear in advocating for a better police-community relation. The BADC is greatly encouraged by the findings and remarks that were made by the Ombudsman. He he touched on many of the concerns the BAD-C and other organizations have voiced over the years, including transparency and accountability. As a contribution to the prevention of crime, BAD-C have conducted conflict mediation programs and training in several training to several members of the community in various priority neighborhoods for the purpose of resolving conflicts in our community. We recommend that barriers should be identified, the barriers to change, and whatever it is that is the impeding factor that contributes to the lack of police accountability. The Attorney General should give the resources or logistics for administrating a complaint and the reprimand of the police to the complaint director to employ a team of investigators for the purpose of investigating complaints against police officers. No police officer or former police officers should be employed in this process. At no stage of the complaint there should be any interference, influence, or investigation by the police. Police must not be seen or considered to be investigating themselves. To allow this, the government of Ontario would be abusing the fundamental principles of fairness, human rights, and justice. The only involvement that the police officer or police official should have in the process of a complaint against the police officer is to answer to the allegation.
I'm going to bring Karen Greenwood Rambler.
Yet another young man taken violently at the hands of the members of the Toronto Police Service. In recognition of the changes the Special Investigations Unit have implemented since the departure of former Director James Cornett, we are hopeful that the SA will conduct a thorough and unbiased investigation. However, no matter what the official result, this event has again placed the issue of how policing services are delivering this problem from front to center. As Ontarians, we must do more than rely on the SAU to investigate these tragic killings after the fact. We must look to the trained police officers receive. By the fact the supervising officer on scene is not designated a suspect officer, we must conclude that the use of force model currently employed in this province allows for an officer to use a taser on a suspect. So having been shot multiple times, was lying prone and bleeding on the floor. Ontarians deserve a lot better. We all do. We deserve a constabulary that considers all loss of life to be tragic, not just those caught on video. There are many marginalized families and disadvantaged people that we talked about today. They need to be considered just as well as anybody standing in this room. We deserve a training regime that looks to avoid the use of violence at all costs, particularly in situations where well-trained, armed, and armored officers outnumber suspects, sometimes 21 to 1. We know this change is possible. We know it. We really do. We all know the change is possible. But it will not occur until the citizens demand it. And just as many of us have said here today, we said the same thing. We need to demand it as Ontarians. We stand with the team of the Elegant, the Christopher Reed, Biotica, Al Nadir, Grahams, Schaefer, the Bossage family. There's so many families that you wouldn't have time to hear the names. We stand with all others who hope to see an end to the census and necessary loss of life.
When you mentioned that the police force started in 1834, and ironically, that's the year that slavery was abolished in this country, August 1st, 1834. Do you think that there is a correlation between that, seeing that the slaveholders no longer had power over their former slaves, and the fact that the government had taken over at that point?
That there's
some correlation there.
Thank you. Not exactly.
At the time in 1834, when the police were incorporated, they were more concerned with the rebellion of William McKinley. And they were concerned with the Fenian raiders who were coming into Canada. At that time, much like today, racialized people like ourselves, we didn't have much of a say within the city. I think the best answer to your question is that no, I don't believe that it was a racial issue per se in terms of color, but yes, most of the policemen at the time in Toronto, they were orange Protestants, and so there was a real divergence of attitudes and views between the police and its citizens, and that still remains today. Although the individuals may have changed, there's a tremendous disconnect from the management of the police and from the police job that they're doing to the real job that we need as citizens to be doing. So I do think that it is kind of a cross understanding of the purpose.
Karen, given that this shooting has a video and there's so much video evidence of what actually took place, do you think that after all of these other incidents that this could be more changing?
I keep going back to a book I read called Malcolm Gladwell. It's called Malcolm Gladwell wrote a book called Tipping Point, and I think this is part of Tipping Point. However, again, it's all due to action from the citizens of Ontario. It's very, very necessary to tip it into that political wake-up call to start looking at this.
We're only going to take questions from the media.
You're calling on an independent investigation. Who do you see taking up that investigation? Who would do that?
Well, we believe that the community should be involved, citizens should be involved. I mean, we're not unhappy with Justice O'Connor, but we don't believe it should just be for the city of Toronto. It's got to go across the province.
But isn't that what the Ombudsman is looking at police training from the highest levels to the front line, and he is province-wide managing it? Isn't he already doing what you're asking for?
Yeah, but it's also come from the Attorney General's office.
Okay, so you want the Attorney General to be doing the review?
That's right.
So maybe you can restate exactly what you're calling for today and why this rally and why you're going to tell us.
Well, I mean, as we explained earlier, the reason that the Ontario Federation involved that, you know, our members asked us to do this. It's about public safety. We have working families. And we want an independent investigation that looks into all the recommendations. We want them to take a look at the saving lives. We want them to take a look at the different reports. Well, more importantly, we want them to implement them. And there's got to be a place. There's got to be a complete review from the Attorney General's office right down to the first line of response.
This is a question for any of the families of the victims. The Eastern family has a long road in front of them. Having all of you gone through yourself, what advice do you
have? Okay, fine. Can you get somebody to
meet with us?
No, we want questions from the
media.
Sorry.
Is the OFL, since they're involved now, willing to support those families who are members of the OFL who would like to file civil suits against police? Are the OFL now willing to support those families financially? Is that why you're involved?
No, we're not involved for this, to support financially. We're involved to make sure that this is an issue, be able to bring families together. All the time.
I actually called Sid Wright. I called the OFL for this reason. Because I saw Ms. Sid's like a message and said, I totally agree with what you said about my performance. Like, I totally supported what you're doing, and I said, you know, I'm an affected family, or I'm a victim's mother, and said, you know, I'd like to do something more, hurting Muller, if we're going to be at the rally, I'm going to chop this down many times. I went to the visitation to see, it was horrible. This team fainted in the middle of the visitation. It's just horrible to look at it in a mother's eyes, full of tears, and know what she's going to go through. Awful. So I called the OFL.
Yeah. That's a great question, though. I really appreciate that question, because that's really what it comes down to for families is financial. That's what it comes down to. If you have a way of raising money, then you can take the support and perhaps win. I mean, I'm just had a day in the Supreme Court. I was embarrassed to be Canadian. The police lawyer actually said in court, in public, that he believed that police should have the help of a lawyer to write their notes, to enhance the notes. That's totally against everything in the Police Services Act. So, you know, without money, we can't do anything. When this is over, you know, I'm 54 years old. I had my savings. I actually think that my money was very well spent, and I don't regret it for a minute, but I do know where I'm going to be when I'm old, and I'm not going to have anything, and I won't have any autonomy because I was old and I won't have anything, and that's directly because nobody comes forward to help families to fight systemic issues, which should be worth backing financially for pretty much every organization in this world.
Listening to all the speakers today, I sense accountability is the top issue here. And a question for Selwyn Peters, in that you've had pretty wide experience at inquests, as have many people here, either seen them or perhaps being witnesses or covering them as media. And Selwyn, in your presentation, you mentioned Policing Standards Committee does set the rules for all police services across the province. And an overwhelming theme from everybody here is inquests have been ignored. Who do you hold ultimately responsible for that lack of action?
Well, it all comes down to the deputy ministers. It comes down to the chiefs of police. It comes down to the senior officers. They all have a role to play in implementing the standards that the province and act so that police officers can perform their duties ethically, professionally, and use the best judgment ability.
Sorry, so could you have you just maybe take the spot there just to answer that again, just so you pick it up on that.
The question was whether given the existence of the Police Standards Division, who do we hold accountable for the lack of implementation or the failure on the ground to utilize the standards that are set for police officers province-wide? And I would say that it starts from the Deputy Minister for the Public Safety Division, going down to the Chiefs of Police, to the senior officers, to frontline police supervisors. The police invest a lot in training, and it is the responsibility of the bureaucrats from the top to the bottom to ensure that that training is meaningful and is used well in the field.
Will things be different this time around, sorry, because of this video?
Things will be substantially different because I mean, the video is a teachable moment for all police officers. It's a teachable moment for civilians. It's a teachable moment for all of us, because when you have shootings, you have the word of an officer versus no one else, because they say dead men tell no tales. And you have, of course, the problems with the SIU investigations that some people have alluded to earlier. So it is a teachable moment, because we've all seen, we all saw what occurred, and we don't need it to be digested for us. It's tangible, it's objective, that the police officers, any training that was provided to those officers fell by the wayside under the day in question. No question about that.
Do you support wearable cameras, perhaps?
Yes.
For police officers?
Yes. Cam, I agree with you that wearable cameras would be a solution as well. Police officers probably should be severely disciplined for turning off those dash cams in their vehicles. A lot of them are turning those dash cams off because they want no objective evidence to capture what happens in the field. And enough disciplinary actions are taken against them. And I mean, there is a call as well. We don't need those lethal weapons that the officers carry. Toronto is not a dangerous city. It is not. You know, a homicide rate in Toronto is probably one of the lowest in the world. We don't need police officers to carry those lethal weapons. There's no serious threat to public safety in Toronto.
Go ahead.
What is the OFL's plan for people going
forward? Going forward, we're going to continue to meet with the community groups. We're going to look together to put a deputation together for the ombudsman and continue with this. Well, as Karen has said, I think I'll have Karen answer the question.
Sorry, I wasn't quite sure what was going on yet. I just wanted to make one point. I'm not minimizing your question. I just wanted to answer one question that was answered before. My son's death was caught on video. They asked that you had it. They didn't release it to me. I didn't get to see it until the pre-inquest. At which time I was shocked what they did. Shooting my son and keeping him in the genitals numerous times. I saw the video. There isn't just that video. There's many videos out there. And there's a lot of evidence that the SIU holds close to their chest that they don't release. I've been trying to get a hold of that video just because I think I should have it. Because I think I want to be a PD someone. And I'm still going to vote for it. I've spoken to Jack Scambrough, the regional coroner for Hamilton and Waterloo Region. And he knows me. I've walked out of many corners and parts where I've been supporting other families. I couldn't be here today because of the trauma.
What kind of support? Financial support?
I don't know, my social assistance. I've lost my home, my car, everything. Everything. Dignity.
I want to add something to that because Karen is really good. When my son was killed, I didn't find out for 2 days. I was working as a human rights worker in the jail less than I found. I was well known by the police. I worked with the police. They would be able to find me in about half an hour. They didn't find me in 2 days. They told me it was because they didn't know what my son's name was. He self-identified. He told them the truth. He had his ID on him, which I can't get back. I've been trying for 4 years to get his ID on. At the inquest, there were four of us. We were surrounded by a sea of police, all with weapons. At one point, my daughter moved to the Crown
I'd like to thank everybody. We've got to get to the rally. We'd like to, we appreciate everybody. We appreciate the families and women. Okay, thank you very much.
I think
the rally is at 1 Dundas. It starts at 1 Dundas and then it's a march to
12 noon.
Yeah, 12 noon.
I'd just like to say, though, that if there are reporters who'd like to do one-on-one interviews with family members, I think there might be some room to do some of that in the hallway. Maybe family members who are willing to take those interviews one-on-one might want to come stand over here. Is anybody doing French meetings?